In the last video, I was talking about this band engineering for making these multi-junction solar cells, and I was particularly looking at the case of a solar cell which had three junctions. And fortuitously, we came across this material system which gives us these three semiconductor, germanium, gallium arsenide, and indium gallium phosphide, which are lattice matched to each other, so I can grow them on top of each other without creating defects. And I can make a solar cells. And in fact, the solar cell, it gives me efficiencies of approximately 400 for approximately 40% at a concentration of 500 suns. And further looking deeper into it, we found that this efficiencies was limited by essentially this bottom cell, which had a band gap which was less than what was desired. So it had a band gap of 0.7 electron volt, which resulted in a high short circuit current for this junction. But that was not really useful because the overall current of the cell, which is constant throughout the three junctions, was limited by the top and the middle junction, which had much lower current as compared to this germanium cell. And also, since this had lower band gap, this resulted in lower open circuit voltage for this cell. And since the open circuit voltage of my overall cell is essentially related to the open circuit voltage of this individual cell, it's given by the sum of these three. So my overall open circuit voltage was also, slightly lower because of band gap of germanium being less than optimal. So now, what do I do about it? So there are two ways I can essentially, get around this problem. One is to lower the band gap of these two materials. So essentially, lower the band gap of my top cell and my intermediate cell. So essentially, they also will now absorb more of the spectrum. So the short circuit current of these two cells, which is top cell and intermediate cell, will hopefully increase. And it will hopefully become closer to what germanium gives, and my short circuit current of my overall cell will improve. So that's one way I can improve my overall efficiency. The other way I can think about is, I can replace this germanium with something else which has a higher band gap. So in that way, the short circuit current of this germanium of this bottom cell will decrease, but its open circuit voltage will increase, and hopefully again I'll get some increase in the efficiency. So now let's look at how I can go about realizing both these approaches. So let me start with the first approach, where what I want to do is I want to reduce the band gap of these two materials which I used to make the top cells. So this indium gallium phosphide, which is used for making the top cell, and then this gallium arsenide, which is used for making the intermediate cell. So to reduce the band gap, I look at again this band gap versus lattice constant, and I see that if I essentially mix this gallium arsenide with the indium arsenide, so essentially I form this indium gallium arsenide, then it has a reduced band gap as compared to gallium arsenide, but it lies on the right-hand side of this gallium arsenide and germanium, so it has a higher lattice constant. So if I go to higher lattice constant, I mix my gallium arsenide with indium, then I get a lower band gap of this resulting material, which is indium gallium arsenide. Another way I can reduce the band gap of this top material, which is indium gallium phosphide. Sorry, I stated it to be indium gallium arsenide. This is indium gallium phosphide. So similarly for this top material, indium gallium phosphide, if I essentially increase my indium percentage, I move closer to indium phosphide. So I'll have a lattice constant which is higher, but I'll have a band gap which will be reduced as compared to this indium gallium phosphide with 50% of gallium and 50% of indium. So if I increase the indium percentage more than 50, I essentially get a lower band gap but a slightly higher lattice constant. So if I increase both the lattice constant of this indium gallium arsenide and the lattice constant of this indium gallium phosphide by increasing the indium percentage, I'll essentially reduce their band gap. And this you know is shown more zoomed out over here. So if I look over here, I see that my germanium is lattice matched to gallium arsenide and this indium gallium phosphide with 50% indium. If I increase the indium percentage over to 65%, I see that I'm reducing my band gap from this value of 1.8 to I'm reducing it further. Similarly, I'm reducing the band gap of gallium arsenide when I'm mixing it with indium. So if I'm mixing it with 17% indium, I have reduced its band gap. But at the same time, I see a problem with this approach too. That is, I have increased the lattice constant of these two materials. So now these two materials are no longer lattice matched to germanium. There's a lattice mismatch over here. So when I start growing these materials on top of germanium, I expect defects to form between this germanium and this indium gallium arsenide indium gallium arsenide layer, and that is shown over here. So if I do in fact do take this travel down this path, when I start growing this epitaxial indium gallium arsenide layer on top of germanium, there'll be defects which be created over here because of the lattice constant mismatch between these two materials, and these defects would further propagate throughout the rest of the cell. So these defects will also propagate into the indium gallium phosphide layer, which is grown on top of this indium gallium arsenide layer. So I see this is very nicely shown in this transmission electron microscope picture over here. So over here I have germanium and germanium substrate, and when I'm starting to grow this indium gallium arsenide with 17% indium on top of it, I see that these defects, these threading dislocations and these stacking faults are forming in this material, and they essentially continue to creep into all the other layers which are grown on top of this material as well. So approach that is used is to essentially make this metamorphic layer, or make this buffer of put a buffer of this indium gallium arsenide material, and it's usually a thick buffer, a few microns or less than or greater than a micron in thickness, and it essentially the purpose here to absorb this lattice mismatch and hopefully terminate a lot of these stacking faults and these threading dislocations within this buffer layer. So this is this metamorphic technique of growing this cell. I can essentially realize this cell, which is germanium at the bottom, and then I have indium gallium arsenide with approximately 17% indium, and then I have this indium gallium phosphide with high percentage of indium as well. So I can see now my short circuit current of my top cell has increased. So as compared to 14, it has now increased. It has now increased to close to 16, or at maximum 16.5, and the short circuit current of my intermediate cell has also increased. At the same time, the short circuit current of my bottom cell, which was 25 before, is now substantially reduced because a lot more of the photon, a lot more of my photons, or a lot more of my spectrum is being now absorbed by this top and intermediate cell, because now they have lower band gaps. As a result, less spectrum is available for germanium. And I see that now approximately the currents of these three cells, of these three junctions, are matched with each other. But at the same time, since I have reduced the band gap of this top cell, its VOC will decrease. Similarly, I've reduced the band gap of this intermediate cell, so its open circuit voltage will also reduce. So, and also I have this problem of these defects in the metamorphic layer, which propagate reduce the efficiency of both this intermediate cell as well as this top cell. As a result of that, I get efficiency improvements as compared to a lattice matched system, which has an efficiency of this case 40.1. I can improve my efficiency to 40.7, but it's not, the gain is not substantial because of all these bad things which come along with going to a metamorphic system which has a large amount of lattice mismatch. So now let's look at the second method, which involves replacing this germanium, which had a lower band gap and was causing all the problems, with some another material which has a higher band gap as compared to germanium. So I look for material which might have higher band gap as compared to germanium, and I realize that I can use something like indium gallium arsenide. I can mix this gallium arsenide over here with the indium arsenide, which has a very high lattice constant, and I can realize, you know, I can make a material which has a higher band gap as compared to germanium. But now I need to grow it on top of something. So immediately, if I look up and down below this gallium arsenide, I don't see any native semiconductors such as silicon or germanium. So the only way to grow this indium gallium arsenide would be to grow it on top of, let's say, germanium or gallium arsenide. But if I start with, let's say, germanium and grow this indium gallium arsenide, there'll be a lot of defects which would be created, because this indium gallium arsenide has a larger lattice constant. So there's a large lattice mismatch over here. And all the subsequent layers, such as my gallium arsenide or my indium gallium phosphide, which would be grown on top, would have these defects as well, because these defects will propagate into whatever is grown on top of this indium gallium arsenide as well. So we use an approach which is what's called an inverse metamorphic approach. So what is done in this approach is that you start with gallium arsenide. So you start with the gallium arsenide, and then you grow the material which has the highest band gap, which should usually be on the top, which should be facing the sunlight. So you grow this indium gallium phosphide first, and then you grow gallium arsenide again on top, which is your intermediate band gap material. And then finally, at the very end of the growth, you grow this indium gallium arsenide material, which is the material you need for your bottom cells. So the defects are in fact created when you grow this indium gallium arsenide on top of gallium arsenide, but at least they are contained in this cell which is made out of indium gallium arsenide only. So the defects which are created here, they are contained in this cell. And now what is done is you essentially peel off these layers which you have grown. So you peel off these layers on top which you grew on top of gallium arsenide, and then you flip the cell over, and the indium gallium phosphide layer which you grew on the top at the start of your epitaxy, it becomes the top layer, and this gallium arsenide which you grew in between, it becomes your middle cell. And this indium gallium arsenide layer, which had most of the defects, it becomes your bottom cell. So you can see over here that, you know, the defects are contained in this bottom cell, and they at least do not affect these top two cells. And this approach is called an inverse metamorphic buffer, because this metamorphic layer is located essentially towards the bottom instead of propagating throughout the cell. So these are some of the engineering techniques we can use to essentially limit the pitfalls of this three junction system and improve its efficiency. There are other techniques as well. More recently, you know, there's a technique which involves wafer bonding, that is, you know, growing two of these junctions at once and growing the other junction in separate epitaxial processes and then bonding them together. This is also being researched by several groups and being pursued by quite a few startups. There's also a lot of buzz around use of these dilute nitride system, which have many of these materials. They also achieve a band gap which is intermediate between gallium arsenide and germanium. So you can replace your bottom junction with this dilute nitride system as well. So hopefully, you know, I've given you some idea of how this lattice matching, it essentially limits the amount of band engineering that you can do, and some of the tricks people play to achieve the band gaps they want.